Yeah. morning. A couple things in your worship folder I want to point out. Number one says nominating committee today. That's actually next week. I think most of the nominating committee knows that. But that is next Sunday, not today. Today is the big thing today. It's church picnic day. We've been talking about it for several weeks now. Today is the day, 5 p.m. today. We'll be over on this side of the building. Come around 5, bring your side dishes, desserts, all that kind of stuff. The deacons will take care of hamburgers, hot dogs, and all the fixes with those and the drinks. So be here today at 5. I'd like somebody to come with you. We'd love to have them as well. A couple things coming up that I need to mention. The 20th of October, we're having a fall festival here. That's a Sunday afternoon. So you want to plan to be here for that. You want to start inviting some people to come to that on the 20th. And then on October 27th, we're going to be having a comedy show here that night. It is what it sounds like, a comedy show. It's going to be a lot of fun. The guy that's doing it, he's actually a pastor for sales. He was in comedy. He was one of my roommates at college. He was in comedy kind of right out of college, went out to California, did some things, and then decided he was going into ministry and some other things he was doing. But in the last 5 years, he's gotten back into it and done quite well. And so he's going to be here for a comedy show. It's actually going to be a fundraiser for our Guatemala trip for next summer. It's basically just donations. It's free to get in, so invite some people to come with you. It'll be a great time. That's on October 27th. We'll be putting out more details in the coming weeks for that. Again, we're glad you're here this morning. Let's worship together.
Good morning. As we gather here and as we start our time of worship, and as we sing and listen to the words of this first song, maybe thinking as this is our call to worship and a prayer for us as we focus our hearts and focus our minds on Jesus, as we are sitting now in his presence. Let me pray for us as we get started and lead into this song. We are thankful, Jesus, that you are here and that you have always been here since the beginning. And so we sit now in your presence and we worship now through these songs, focusing our eyes on you, focusing our hearts on you. And God, as this first song says, may all the things that we have encountered over the last few, maybe days, weeks, maybe years, that have weighed heavy on us, may those things in your presence grow dim. Again, I also pray that as we process those things in light of who you are and the understanding of who we are in you, that God, you will use all things and knowing that you use all things for your glory. This is your time, Jesus, to speak to us now. As we sing and as we listen, as we receive your word, and also receive the elements that represent your body. God, right now, I may not know what you're doing. Oh, but I know what you've done. For me and for us. And so we praise you now. Thank you. Continue to worship this song to you now about your goodness.
Receiving communion at the conclusion of the service, so I hope the wind doesn't sweep you away too quickly. But Lee, thank you again. He was Johnny on the spot 2 weeks ago. I had a bad reaction to the fun ambulance ride to the UK and spent about, how long was I there? Where did Deb go? I was there a long time. We got home about 5 that afternoon. I was not worth looking at or dealing with, so I appreciate you filling that spot so handily, Lee, and then taking care of last week. And last week he was dealing with, what am I here for? What is my life about? What is my purpose? And a perfect follow-up on that is, what are you living for? What is our purpose in life? What are we aiming at? It's hard to hit a target if you don't aim. And, you know, I've never shot an arrow, never shot a gun. Well, I did shoot a gun, but I didn't tell my dad about it. But I've never shot at a target, never shot at any kind of moving objects or anything. But, you know, the concept, what are you living for? There are any number of directions that a person can take when they're trying to figure out what to live for this side of heaven. Some people tend to look forward, focusing on their plans and their goals and what lies ahead. Other people, they tend to look backward at all of their past choices and decisions they made and mistakes they made in the past. Some people look down on other people, hoping that somewhere they can make themselves feel better about where they are in life. And then other people look around to see what everybody else is doing. You kind of get that. You know, if you see what somebody else is doing, maybe if I do that, I'll be happy. Those kind of things are what we tend to focus on in life. But God, in our text for today, in this passage this morning, God says to look up. You don't get those words exactly in our text, but basically, he says to look up, to set your hearts and your minds on things above. On things above. I like that. I like that. So, how should we live if we've been raised with Christ? That's the opening comment that Paul makes in Colossians, and we're in Colossians 3, verses 1 through 4. And that's the opening comment he makes. You've been raised with Christ. So, William Hendrickson sums it all up this way. He says, believers should be consistent. They should live in conformity with the fact that they were raised with Christ, who is their life. I like that. I like that. So let's look, with our title being, what are you living for? Let's look at what Paul had to say in verses 1 through 4. First thing he says, if then you were raised with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ is, sitting at the right hand of God. Set your mind on things above, not on things of the earth. For you died, and your life is hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is our life, appears, then you also will appear with him in glory. I like that. That's a nice goal to think toward. But Paul, the first thing he says is, if you were raised with Christ, then you should seek heavenly things. Seek heavenly things. Specifically, he says, seek those things
which are above. Now, the things above that Paul's talking about are heavenly things, eternal things, the things of God, rather than the things of man or the things of this earth. Things above, those things that last forever. Not the temporary things that you see right in front of you. The things that sometimes we chase after, and sometimes actually the things that we are chasing after we tend to fall over. You know what I mean? Things that trip us up. Things that knock us down. Things that take advantage of us and rob us of what life is really all about. Now, when you're thinking about things of this earth, Matthew 6, Jesus said these words. He said, "Do not store up for yourself treasures on earth, where moth and rust destroy and where thieves break in and steal. But store up for yourselves treasures in heaven." Let's think about things above. Setting your heart on things above. Things in heaven, treasures in heaven, where moth and rust do not destroy and where thieves do not break in and steal. And I like this line, "For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also." The things that you focus on, the things that your heart is going after, that's where you lay up treasure. That's the thing, that's where our focus is, and that's where our heart is, and that's where our treasure is. Paul gives two commands to us as followers of Christ in this passage. The first command, if you look at it, it's hard to see them as commands, but the first command he gives is to set your hearts on things above. The word translated here as seek those things, is actually translated as set your hearts on something. Not necessarily on things above, but to set your hearts on something. And specifically, it's the same word that's used in the Sermon on the Mount when Jesus said to seek first the kingdom of God. To seek first the kingdom of God. And so when Paul tells you to seek those things that are above, he is talking about setting your hearts on what Christ came to establish as our focus in life. The kingdom of God. He is saying that a Christian, as a Christian, you have a new direction, you have a new goal in your life. You are no longer to seek those things that are on earth, but to set your heart on things above. So Paul's reason to seek those things that are above is because that is where Christ is seated in authority. Where Christ is seated in authority. He says specifically where Christ is sitting at the right hand of God. Now here's the key. If you love Jesus, if you hunger and thirst after him, if you want to be with him someday, then your focus should be, number one, where he is. And then Matthew Henry says that that is where your best friend is. There's nobody that you should be closer to than you're closer to Jesus. And that's something we should focus on every day, getting closer to Jesus. And I want to say thank you again to Scott for helping me every day, sending a text that helped me focus on getting closer to Jesus. Sometimes it's hard to focus on Jesus when you're in a building with a bunch of people that don't talk a whole lot about Jesus. Some of the words they use are not real nice. I need a PG rating when I walk in the door. I mean, it needs to be there. But it's good to get inside that building and to catch a break and to catch my breath and to focus on what's there. And that's what Jesus is wanting us to focus on. To focus on him. Matthew Henry says that that is where your best friend is. And he's advanced to the highest rank, the highest dignity, the highest honor in heaven, and has established this heavenly focus for us to seek after. The right hand of God is actually, in Latin, it's dextera domini. I know, you're not going to, our teenagers, you're not going to go to to school tomorrow, start using these Latin words just to impress everybody and just throwing out words like dexterra domini, and everybody's going to say, what did you say? Can you spell that? That's where you get into trouble, when you got to spell something that you say. Dexterra domini, it literally means it's a metaphor for the omnipotence of God. The omnipotence. There were three omni words. Omnipresence, meaning God is everywhere all the time. Omniscience, meaning God knows everything that you do, you think, you say. He knows it all. And omnipotence, which means that God has unlimited power and authority. Unlimited power and authority. So that first command that Paul gives is to set your heart on things above. And in that context, Christ is seated at the right. He's in a position of authority and a position of power. And if we focus on him and we unite with him in this life, then we bring the power from heaven into our lives, and it changes the game. Nothing will ever be the same when he's in your heart and he's ruling your life, and that power of God, with him seated at the right hand of God, that power of God is working in and through your heart and life. Nothing can touch that. Nothing can touch that. So, the first command, set your heart on things above. Next, Paul tells us what to set your mind on. And that deals with the second command, where Paul says to set your mind on things above. First of all, set your heart on things above. That means your passions, what you care about, what you seek after. The second thing he says to set your mind on is, what he is saying is to think about eternal things. To think about eternal things. And he specifies not on things of the earth, not on things on the earth. The last phrase does not mean that nothing on earth is of eternal value. That's important to recognize. It doesn't mean that everything that we encounter here, everything that's right in front of us, is not of eternal value. There are things of eternal value that we encounter this side of heaven. Otherwise, we couldn't help people find their way to salvation, their way to Jesus, their way to find hope, their way to live a life of meaning and purpose. They couldn't find those things if there was nothing of eternal value this side of heaven. Now, a few weeks ago, I quoted the words of a song that was recorded in May of 1971 by John Lennon. And the last words of that chorus said, imagine all the people living for today. And that's pretty much what everybody's doing. They're living for today. But that context of imagine, when we're thinking about focusing on eternal things, on things above. I like another song that was recorded in 1998 by Bart Millard. Bart had just been through some tough times. I don't know if you've seen the movie, I Can Only Imagine, but it kind of tells his story. He was raised with a dad that abused him. And he passed away in 1991. 7 years later, Bart wrote a song that was based largely on what his grandmother said to him at the graveside. He was angry. His dad had been diagnosed 4 years earlier at the age of 44 with cancer. And he died 4 years later at the age of 48 in 1991. And he was angry. All of his life he'd been praying for God to change his dad. And he did. And then he took him away. It's easy to see why Bart could be angry about that. Why didn't you change it and then take him home? At the graveside, his grandmother told him, said, I can only imagine what your dad's seeing right now. Those words were like a haunting melody that he kept hearing every day, throughout the day. Every morning he'd wake up, those words were there. Every night when he'd go to bed, those words were there. I can only imagine. until one day he wrote the rest of that song. I can only imagine. He let his imagination run wild. And he wrote these words, "Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your glory, or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak it all? I can only imagine." I don't know about you, but I like Bart Millar's imagination. Many times more than John Lennon's. That's an imagination that should overwhelm us. And not just overwhelm us, it should possess our hearts and minds so that we think like he thought. We live. Created us to live. It's not just a passion of heart, but it's a focus of our minds on what we're to be living like and living for. I think that's what Paul meant when he said, "Set your mind on things above instead of the busyness of earth." The busyness of earth. Things on earth, they stand in opposition of the things in heaven most of the time. Not all of the time, but most of the time. Matthew Henry says that we must not dote upon the things of the earth, or expect too much from them, for we may set our affections on heaven, for heaven and earth are contrary one to the other. A supreme regard to both is inconsistent, and the prevalence of our affections to one will greatly weaken the state of our affections to the other. In other words, if we become more passionate about stuff of this earth, then heaven fades into the background. We sang a song just a moment ago, "Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in his wonderful face." Listen to these words. "And the things of earth will grow strangely in the light of his glory and grace." When we focus on him, stuff of earth has less of a grip on our heart and less of a possession on our thoughts and our minds. Barnes' note says that wealth, honor, and pleasure are like varmints that are always nipping at your toes and grabbing at your heels. We got varmints in our house that are always doing that. You don't walk around our house barefoot. Your toes become victims, and your hands too. Deb will tell you, she'll be walking down the hallway and they're always jumping and nipping at her hands. And that's the concept of what the earth does. It's always chasing after us. It's always trying to possess us, trying to latch on to us and get a grip on what matters to us. So when Paul says, when he talks about earthly things, he says not necessarily, he's not necessarily talking about sinful things. And that's important to recognize, because not everything that you encounter this side of heaven is sinful. Not everything. Many things are. But some earthly things, that some are sinful, but not all are. That would be making the same assumption or mistake that the false teachers in Paul's day made when they said that everything material and physical was evil. So you had to focus. That's how they were able to draw people into philosophy and getting them to think as a philosopher would think. The sin is not necessarily an earthly thing. It's not sinful in and of itself. But focusing on those things, setting your mind on earthly things, can draw you away from the things that really matter. That's what Paul is saying. The busyness of earthly things can be all-consuming to the point that You have no time to think about anything else, specifically about heavenly things. Now, the last point that Paul makes here is Paul says that you are a dead man walking. A dead man walking. He doesn't use those words exactly, but 2 weeks ago I referred to you and me as a dead man walking, and I made a reference to zombie movies. I don't watch zombie movies, but it's intriguing to think in that context that we are a dead man walking. Paul says, for you died, and your life is hidden with Christ in God. Barnes Note says that you are dead to the world, just like Jesus was dead to sin, dead to this life when he was put in the grave, when he was buried. He was dead to earthly pleasures, and likewise we should be as well. The idea that Paul is teaching here is Christ became literally dead in the tomb. So if we are dead with Christ, then we should consider ourselves removed from the stuff of this life that draws us away from Christ, that draws us away from God. The language here is taken probably from treasure, a context of a treasure which is hidden or concealed. I still remember when we lived north of Florence, Alabama, there was a little boy that a couple had, I just blank on his name. But they had a little boy that he loved treasure maps. When he would come to church, he always would come up and ask me if I had a treasure map. So I'd just take a bulletin and just draw lines all around the bulletin. And then on the back cover, I would hide a little treasure chest. And he would find it under some of the words. Or if I got creative, I'd take a piece of tape and put a piece of paper over it so that it literally was buried. And he loved doing that. I'd go to visit them from time to time, and he'd take me out in the yard and show me where he buried treasure. That's the context of something that's hidden with Christ in God. 2 Timothy 1:12, Paul says, "For I know whom I have believed, and am persuaded that he is able to keep that which I have committed unto him against that day." Keep it. You see, if we hide the treasures, you remember what Jesus said in Matthew 6? For where your heart is, or where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. If we hide what matters most to us in Christ, he is able to keep that. He is able to keep that until someday when we inherit the glory of what we've laid up with Christ in God. And I love Paul's focus here at the end. He talks about when Christ appears. When Christ, who is our life, appears, then you also will appear with him in glory. Christ is a believer's life. He is our principle. He is our end. He is our beginning, and he is our finish line. He is the one that we begin life with and we will finish life with. That he is the beginning and the end. I love that. And we live in him, and he lives in us by the presence of his Holy Spirit. So there's that continuous connectedness with him. And so we should live in him in all we do. Christ will appear again. He is now hidden in heaven with God so that we don't see him, but hopefully we see him everywhere we go. That should be our faith in action. We see him everywhere we go. But this is the glorious bottom line. Paul says that we will appear with him in glory. It will be his glory that all the redeemed will come back. That's the hope that we have in him. Now, back to that original line. What are you living for? I think to put it in proper context, we should add something else to that question. Are the things you're living for worth Christ dying for? That's what we're about to do. We're about to honor Christ's death for us. And that question puts it in proper perspective. Are the things you're living for worth Christ dying for? He died for our sins so that we can have life. And having life means that He lives in us and through us so that everything that He purchased by His death on the cross and His resurrection is what we focus on and we bring glory to Him in and through our lives. I'm going to ask our band to find their way on stage and ask our deacons to make their way to the front row. We're going to prepare to receive communion. They'll come around and they'll give you a chance to take these cups. There's a small filter on top. When you fill it back, you can get the wafer. We'll receive it together, so I'll ask you to hold that until we focus on that wafer, and then we'll do the same thing with the juice. There's a second filter sleeve that you fill back, and we'll receive that juice as well. And so they'll be passing these out in just a moment, and we'll get a chance to focus on Christ and what He did for us. So I'm going to ask you to pray with me as we begin to receive our communion elements. Father, thank you. Thank you for Christ, who is our life. Thank you that Paul said in Colossians 1:27, Christ in you is the hope of glory. And according to Paul, in this passage, when Christ appears, we will appear with Him. What a message. What a hope. God, I pray that you would help us to set our hearts on things above, to set our minds on things above, and to think and to focus and to love the things that Christ died to bring into our life. God, as we prepare to receive these elements, may we recognize that the bread represents the body of Christ, which was broken for us. And the juice represents the blood of Christ, which was shed for us. Because without the shedding of blood, there is no remission or forgiveness of sins. That's what your word says. So God, I pray if there's one here today that knows that there's something sinful in their life, that they'll know that as we receive these elements, that's what you died for, to remove those sins from them. So, Father, I pray that right now they'll simply confess, because 1 John 1:9 says, if we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and to cleanse us of all unrighteousness. God, may these sins be wiped away and washed away in the precious blood of Jesus. For your glory and for our good. So, Father, as we honor you, may you be blessed to bring your glory and your goodness into our hearts and lives. In Jesus' name. Amen. Our deacons for how they serve. This is one of the most meaningful moments when they have a chance to serve you just as Christ did when he established the Lord's Supper the night before he died. He took the bread and he blessed it. He said, "This is my body." What literally his body, but what he was simply saying is this represents said, which is broken for you, as often as you receive it, do this in remembrance. And afterwards, he took the cup. This was the part we experienced most personally. This is my blood. This is the blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you. As often as you receive it, do this in remembrance. I love the fact that it's connected. His life and his death, his sacrifice. In a way, he connected that with us in a way that we can connect regularly. We used to have two stations set up front and back. We're working toward getting back to that point because the pandemic kind of removed the context of going and picking up a piece of bread and dipping it in a cup. It kind of removed that from our access. We're working back toward that so that you can choose anytime you want to receive communion. It's still available in the back every Sunday. If there's a Sunday where you feel like today I need a fresh reminder of what Christ did for me, you can do that. In our our invitation time, our deacons are always available in the back. If you want to just walk up to one of them and say, can you help me receive communion, they will gladly. Again, I appreciate our deacons. We are having a picnic this afternoon, and they'll be serving food. So it's an excellent opportunity to bless our deacons today for the blessing they are. Let's stand and sing as we prepare to leave today. And as we sing, I pray that Christ is real in your heart and life today, and he is your focus as we sing. Amen. Thank you.
into the presence to sit at the table and say, his praise, and just to go out as the disciples did that night, singing. Though they didn't understand what God was doing in their midst. Man, I hope you've heard his voice today as we sing these words again. Stay with us in worship. If you need to head out, please know you may do that. I just want to sit and sing in his presence for a little bit longer. Thank you.
Child.
Yeah, he is a wild child. He's
happy though.
Yeah, he's happy. Yeah. He just doesn't realize that, like, the end of a couch or the end of the bed, there's nothing there.
Something. That's just a long drop.
Yeah, we had a close one as we got to catch him.
Oh, gosh. Y'all need an indoor camera in the room he's in so you can win some money off of these, because there's all kinds of dads diving for baby. He put two in from midfield yesterday.
Thank you.
Nolan drove all the way down, booted it off his kid's hand, and then I gave him the corner, or they got the penalty kick too, and put it in.
Yeah, I saw that penalty kick.
But he drove it all the way down the field and earned the penalty kick.
See you next week.
Hey, we got tickets for that soccer game. Probably the best thing to do might be, can we all fit in one car?
Yeah.
It'd be seven. It's our five and you two.
Yeah, so the five of us.
It's seven of us fit in the car.
One?
Yeah.
Three,
I'm just saying it's $25 cheaper off parking. If we even if we met somewhere between here and Louisville and went in from there.
Well, we talked about, I think we're gonna need to get together to eat Saturday. So we've been trying to find a time to get together anyway.
Pile in the car and go from there. No, it's not. And it's on this side of Louisville, and there's a way back way in. You don't even get near the city. And it's fireworks night afterwards. Just throwing that out. Yeah, and they're not in car seats anymore, but we can keep them out. I've got a park. I went ahead and ordered a parking pass where we always park, and it's one of the closest lots. So if we just pile in one car, we just flash that.
We'll just eat and we'll go from there.
Yeah.
That sounds great. And we'll be at both this summer.
Okay.
Yeah, I think it's 11-1 next Saturday. Hope it cools off. It's a miserable Saturday.
Yeah, you can't. Yeah, that's the only bad thing about it. You cannot get those out of there without
misery.
The
misery of that ball game.
Oh, I'm sure. I had a friend that was in Atlanta, and she's like, you're not at the game first time? We always see you posting from the game, their kid goes there or something. And I'm like, I'm glad I wasn't. Everybody was leaving in the third quarter. I remember, cause
we left.
Tell them to.
I don't think it ever went past the state.
No, it was really hot.
Did
she come to picnic tonight? I don't know. Oh, come on back and eat. She's fragile.
She's fragile.
She's pale.
She was,
I'm not kidding.
You want to go to the office?
She's not perfect.
Stop the
session. She was about done.